Here you can see the internal parts or features of the midbrain. I have put the outline of the midbrain here, and here you can see the narrow passage which passes through the midbrain, that is the cerebral aqueduct, or some people also call it as the aqueduct of Sylvius. And around the cerebral aqueduct there is a central gray matter, and this central gray matter is also called as periaqueductal gray matter. And if you draw an imaginary plane at the level of cerebral aqueduct, an area behind that imaginary plane, this area, that is called as tectum. And if you come to the anterior most part, after the tectum, I am jumping here to the anterior most part. These are posterior and these anterior. Here you can see this the two thick bundle of fibers, corticofugal fibers, and these two structures are called as anterior part of the midbrain. They are called as crus cerebri. And right behind the crus cerebri, you can see a thin sheet of pigmented neurons. That's why I have given two color there. So just to say that it is a pigmented sheet of neurons. And this thin sheet of pigmented neurons, this is called as substantia nigra. And area behind the substantia nigra, this area, but in front of that imaginary plane, so this area is called as tegmentum. So if you talk about the parts, it is tectum, tegmentum, substantia nigra, and the crus cerebri. And one more point, when I talk about these parts, one more point I can tell you. So this tegmentum, substantia nigra, and the crus cerebri, these three parts together, it is called as cerebral peduncle. That's about the parts of internal parts of the midbrain. After knowing the parts of midbrain, now let us take each part and try to discuss some important internal features. Now, first of all, the anterior most structure, that is the crus cerebri. I said crus cerebri, it contains a bundle of axons, mainly the corticofugal fibers coming from the cerebral cortex. And the name of those fibers coming from the cerebral cortex, which are passing through this crus cerebri, they are important fibers. In the middle center, two-third portion, I can say, the center, the majority of the part, it contains corticospinal and corticobulbar fiber. Corticospinal and corticobulbar is also called as corticonuclear. Okay, let me write it here. Corticospinal and corticonuclear. Whereas the medial most part, as well as the lateral most part of the crus cerebri, they have got corticopontine fiber. When I say corticopontine, let me tell you again, this medial part of the crus cerebri, contains the corticopontine fibers coming from the frontal lobe, whereas the lateral most part of the crus cerebri, where it has parietopontine and temporopontine fibers coming from the parietal and temporal lobe of the cerebrum. So remember this part, the center majority of the middle two-third portion of the crus cerebri has got corticospinal fiber, nothing but pyramidal tract, and corticonuclear fiber. These are important structure which are like passing through the crus cerebri. We know that crus cerebri, if you trace it above, it is continuous with the internal capsule, whereas if you trace this crus cerebri below, it is continuous with the basilar part of the pons. That's all about the crus cerebri. Remember this. Okay, now next let us go on to the substantia nigra. Let me draw this substantia nigra somewhere here, a small enlarged part. And here a small enlarged picture of substantia nigra, and it has got two parts. These are posterior and these anterior part. Anterior part, it has got non-pigmented or less pigmented neurons which are loosely arranged. That's why I'm just showing very few neurons. So anterior part of the substantia nigra, it contains non-pigmented or less pigmented neurons, and this anterior part, it is named as pars reticulata, whereas posterior part of the substantia nigra, it contains tightly packed rich pigmented neurons, and this posterior part of the pigmented area of the substantia nigra, it is called as pars compactum. And this pars compactum, the neurons which are there in the pars compactum, posterior aspect of the substantia nigra, they have dopamine as a neurotransmitter, whereas anterior, the neurons which are there in the pars reticulata in the anterior part, they have got either cholinergic or GABAergic neurons. And not only dopamine and GABA neurotransmitter, they also have got melanin pigments in the posterior part. The compactum neurons have got melanin pigments, whereas the neurons which are there in the reticulator, they are rich with the iron compounds. Now, after knowing the pigments and the neurotransmitter and the parts of the substantia nigra, let me talk some important efferent and efferent which you need to know. This substantia nigra, the efferents which are coming to the substantia nigra, they come to the pars reticulata, whereas efferents of the substantia nigra, they leave out through the pars compactum. Now let me talk some important efferent, only important efferent which I will mention here, not all the efferent and all the efferents. Okay, now the efferents which are coming to the pars reticulata substantia nigra, they are the first one, it is called as strionigral fiber. Strio means it is coming from the corpus striatum. In the future classes you are going to study, this corpus striatum is nothing but a part which comes under the basal nuclei, and it comes from the corpus striatum, nothing but caudate nucleus and putamen. And these strionigral fiber coming, that's the important efferent which I am mentioning here, and these fiber, they carry GABA as a neurotransmitter. They carry GABA as a neurotransmitter. And let me erase this name here, okay? Let me write two more efferent. Now one more important efferent which coming to the substantia nigra, that is subthalamic nucleus. From the subthalamic nucleus, subthalamonigral coming from the subthalamic nucleus, and these fiber, efferent fibers, they carry glutamine as a neurotransmitter. And you have pallidonigral and corticonigral. Okay, four efferent I have put: pallidonigral fiber, and coming this. Pallidonigral fiber comes from the globus pallidus. Again, globus pallidus is a part of the basal nuclei. And next one, corticonigral, coming from the cerebral cortex. Corticonigral. Remember, these are the four important efferents. Now, efferent is easy to remember. There is no difficulty in remembering the efferent. Just a reversal of these efferents what I mentioned. There are four efferent I am going to talk. First of all, nigrostriate. Very important fiber, it has got its own clinical importance. See, the efferent, what I said, strionigral, it go back to the same corpus striatum, that means caudate nucleus and putamen. And this first efferent which I am mentioning it here is called as nigrostriate fiber. And this nigrostriate fiber, it carries dopamine as a neurotransmitter. And the next one, nigrosubthalamic fiber. And the next fiber, in the short form I will write here, same nigropallidal fiber. Here in the efferent I said pallidonigral, it go back to the globus pallidus, and that efferent fibers are called as nigropallidal fiber. And the last one, look at the last efferent, then it is easy to remember, coming from the corticonigral, cerebral cortex, and it go back to the cerebral cortex, and that is called as nigrocortical. So remember, my dear friend, nigrostriate, nigrosubthalamic, nigropallidal, and nigrocortical. These are the important efferent fibers. Remember this neurotransmitter, the nigrostriate fibers carries dopamine. Any injury to the nigrostriate fiber, any injury, I will put a cross mark here just to say that if at all if there is any injury to this nigrostriate fiber, that will lead to decreased amount of dopamine in the midbrain, and decreased amount of the dopamine level can cause symptoms of Parkinson. After crus cerebri and substantia nigra, now let us put our focus on the internal features in the tegmental level. Okay. Now since we are talking about the section at the level of superior colliculus, the important structure present in the tegmentum at the level of superior colliculus, it is the presence of this nucleus, that is red nucleus. So these are the two red nuclei. The red nucleus is highly vascular. Because of the high vascularity, it is red. It is 5 millimeter in diameter, and this red nucleus, any damage to the red nucleus, it can lead to contralateral tremor, means tremor on the opposite side of the body. And now let me talk about some important connections, efferent and efferent connections of the red nucleus. Okay. So here you can see the both the red nuclei, and here the midline will come. Imagine there is a midline here. So bilateral red nuclei, I have put it here. Now let me talk about some important efferents. The efferents which are coming to the red nuclei, they are cerebellorubral. Coming from the cerebellum to the red nucleus, cerebellorubral. They come from the dentate, globose, and emboliform nuclei of cerebellum. I repeat again, they come from the contralateral side of the dentate, emboliform, and globose nuclei of cerebellar hemisphere. Okay, from the opposite side. So that is a cerebellorubral fiber. The next efferent which I am talking about here, corticorubral, coming from the primary and premotor cortical area of the cerebral cortex, area number 4 and 6, corticorubral. One more efferent, that is pallidorubral, coming from the globus pallidus of the basal nuclei. And yeah, these are the three important efferent. There is one more that is called as pectorubral,
Let me not mention that. Remember, there is a small contribution even from the superior colliculus to the red nucleus, that is tectorubral fiber. So cerebellorubral, corticorubral and pallidorubral, these are all the important efferent. Now, efferent fibers of red nuclei, they are majority of the efferents, they crosses the midline and they go on the opposite side. It's like that. The majority of the efferents, they cross. When the efferent fibers of the red nuclei, when they cross, they cross here. Let us show that here. And crossing of these efferent fibers in the tegmentum, in the anterior part of the tegmentum, this event is called as ventral tegmental decussation. It is called as what? Ventral tegmental decussation. Now, if you come back to this, ventral tegmental decussation, these ventral tegmental decussation, which contains crossed efferent fiber, they contains rubrospinal, which goes to anterior horn of the spinal cord, facilitates flexor muscles. So if you think for a moment, it is from the motor cortex of the cerebrum to the red nucleus and from the red nucleus to the anterior horn of a spinal cord. It is like an indirect pathway, is an alternative pathway for the pyramidal tract, where in the pyramidal tract, corticospinal, they go directly from the motor cortical area of the cerebrum to the anterior horn of the spinal cord. Whereas here, from the motor cortex of the cerebrum to the spinal cord, in between there is a red nucleus here. It's an alternative pathway for the pyramidal tract. Okay, first important efferent is rubrospinal. The next one, rubrobulbar. Bulbar or rubronuclear, but I prefer to call it as a rubrobulbar. It goes to, rubrobulbar fibers goes to the motor nuclei of 5th and 7th cranial nerves. Okay, the next one, rubroreticula, going to the reticular nuclei of the medulla oblongata, rubroreticula. And these are all the crossed fiber. There is one more uncrossed fiber which runs ipsilaterally, that is rubroolivary. Rubro-olivary fibers, they go from the ipsilateral side of the red nucleus to the inferior olivary nucleus of medulla oblongata. And importance of this, it is just to make a feedback circuit between the red nucleus and the cerebellum. If you think carefully, look at here, come back to the efferent. Here, first efferent, what I mentioned here, it is coming from the cerebellum to the red nucleus, cerebellorubral. So, cerebellorubral and rubroolivary, and from the inferior olivary nucleus, it will go back to the cerebellum. It's like a neuronal circuit formed between the cerebellum, red nucleus, and inferior olivary nucleus, and back to cerebellum. So, my dear students, these are the important crossed efferent fiber. And this is the uncrossed efferent fiber of the red nucleus. And before I wind up this red nucleus point, I just want to say any injury to the red nucleus will lead to contralateral tremor. Talking about this ventral tegmental decussation, nothing but contains all the different important efferent fibers of the red nuclei. Now, one more tegmental decussation which happens in the posterior part of the tegmentum here, that is coming from the coming from the superior colliculi, you have one more efferent fiber, which crosses in the tegmentum like this. And this is called as dorsal tegmental decussation, which contains mainly tectospinal fibers. Let me label that. Yeah, so in the tegmentum of the superior colliculi, we saw the ventral tegmental decussation, which contains efferent fibers of the red nucleus, and dorsal tegmental decussation, which contains tectospinal fibers. And apart from the tectospinal and all these events, now one more structure which I would like to show it here, that is, let me show it here on either side of the midline. And these two are the bundle of fibers coming from the vestibular nuclei, okay, and they are named as medial longitudinal fasciculus. Okay, now apart from knowing the important apart from all these important structure, medial longitudinal fasciculus, dorsal and ventral tegmental decussation, now I am going to mention about some of the important ascending tract in the tegmentum. They are and these are nothing but medial lemniscus, trigeminal lemniscus, and spinal lemniscus. Medial lemniscus, I think you know about all these important lemniscus, nothing but ascending pathways, important major sensory tract. Medial lemniscus is the upward continuation of the fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus, which carries important sensation like tactile discrimination, tactile localization, and stereognosis. In a short form, I can say conscious proprioceptive information along with the fine touch. Trigeminal lemniscus, it carries pain and temperature from the opposite side of the face. So spinal lemniscus is nothing but the upward continuation of lateral spinothalamic tract. So any injury to the spinal lemniscus, you will have loss of pain and temperature from the opposite side of the body. It means indirectly, I talked about the function of the spinal lemniscus. It carries pain and temperature sensation from the opposite side of the body. These are the important ascending pathways which you can see in the tegmentum. Okay. Now, apart from this, you have some other important nuclei. I'll just mention it here. They are rostral interstitial nucleus of medial longitudinal fasciculus, and you have interstitial nucleus of Cajal, as well as, and within the periaqueductal gray matter, you have nucleus of Dapsiewicz. Nucleus of Dapsiewicz, interstitial nucleus of Cajal, and rostral interstitial nucleus of medial longitudinal fasciculus, all these nuclei, they help in either upward gaze or downward gaze movement of the eyeball, means they help in the vertical gaze movement of the eyeball by having a connection with the oculomotor nuclear complex. And I will label these nuclei later. So these are the accessory oculomotor nuclei. Okay, now after mentioning about all these important events in the tegmentum, now I will slowly go to the tectum area. In the tectum, in the tectum,
we have as the heading indicates, we are in the superior colliculus level. Okay, now let us talk about the function and important efferent and efferent connections of the superior colliculus. Now let me draw that superior colliculus on this side. Here you can see the two superior colliculi. Now let me talk about important efferent connection first. The first important efferent connection coming from the area number 8 and area number 18 and 19 of cerebral cortex. From the cerebral cortex, this is the motor cortical area of the cerebrum, and these are the association visual cortical area of the cerebrum. So these are frontal eye field, they are the occipital eye field that you will study in the cerebrum. The first efferent connection of the superior colliculus, here I am mentioning, it is the corticotectal fiber coming from the cerebral cortex. Remember these functional areas. The next efferent connections coming from the retina. When I say coming from the retina, I should say from the retina superior colliculi, it receives the information via optic nerve, chiasma and optic tract, and before it goes to the lateral geniculate body, some of the fibers from the optic tract enters the superior colliculi through the superior brachium, and these retinotectal fibers, they carry contralateral homonymous visual field areas. The next efferent fiber to the superior colliculi, they are coming from inferior colliculus. From the inferior colliculus, this important connection is responsible for when you turn your head and neck muscle and eye muscles towards the auditory source, towards the source of auditory stimulation. When you turn your eye muscle and neck muscle, that kind of reflex action is because of this, all these neuronal connections, and this fiber coming from inferior colliculus to superior colliculus. Then you have one more efferent fiber, that is spinotectal, coming from the spinal cord to the superior colliculus. Spinotectal fibers, it comes along with the spinothalamic tract in the spinal cord in the anterolateral system, and this tract efferent fiber, it carries information concerned with the slow pain and sensory information concerned with the spinovisual reflex. So that is about the spinotectal fiber. So these are the four important efferent. I repeat, corticotectal, retinotectal, from the inferior colliculus and from the spinal cord, that is in the form of spinotectal fiber. Okay, now the efferent connections of superior colliculus, they are the one which is crossing and going on the contralateral, that is tectospinal fiber. Just few minutes before I said in the dorsal tegmental decussation, these tectospinal fibers forms the dorsal tegmental decussation. Tectospinal fibers are responsible for spinovisual reflex, means like reflex contraction of the neck muscles and the eye muscles towards the source of stimulation. Okay, then other than the tectospinal, the other important efferent fibers, they are tectopontocerebellar fiber. This is pontine nuclei in the pons. Tectopontocerebellar fiber. Remember, after the tectospinal, I talked about tectopontocerebellar fiber for the smooth coordination of the eye muscles and the neck muscles. Okay, yeah. And the next efferent fibers, which I am mentioning it here, that is tectobulbar fiber.
Tectobulbar fibers, they go to motor nuclei of third cranial nerve, fourth cranial nerve, sixth cranial nerve for conjugate movement of the eyeball, as well as tectobulbar fibers also go to motor nucleus of the facial nerve, that is for the protective closure of the eyelids. So tectobulbar fibers, I repeat again, it goes to motor nuclei of third, fourth, sixth cranial nerve nuclei, plus it also go to motor nuclei of seventh cranial nerve. And these are all the efferent and efferent fibers of superior colliculus. These are the superior colliculi. Okay, and there are some other efferent fibers coming from the superior colliculi. They are tectoreticular fiber going to the reticular nuclei of the medulla oblongata, and it also go to tectothalamic fiber, going to the nuclei of the thalamus. Tectothalamic and tectopontocerebellar, tectospinal and tectobulbar fiber. These are the important efferent and efferent connections of superior colliculi. After talking about the efferent and efferent connections of superior colliculi, now one more important nuclear structure which I am keeping it right very close to the superior colliculus, that is this is pretectal nuclei, or you can say pretectal area. I labeled it as a pretectal area, and this pretectal nucleus is important for pupillary light reflex and also important for vertical gaze movement. At the level of superior colliculus in the periaqueductal gray matter, you can see the third cranial nerve nuclei, the oculomotor nuclei. So some people, they call it as an oculomotor nuclear complex because it has got segments. And this oculomotor nuclear complex, oculomotor nuclei, they supply extra ocular muscles except superior oblique and lateral rectus muscle, because superior oblique is supplied by trochlear and lateral rectus is supplied by the abducens. And you can see the course of these axons passes through the red nuclei and emerges anteriorly at the medial aspect of the crus cerebri. Okay, and this oculomotor nuclear complex, it has got one important segment that is called as Edinger-Westphal nucleus. Here you can see the two oculomotor nuclei which I kept it here, and I said it has got many small segments, and one of the important segment is Edinger-Westphal nucleus. Okay, yeah, now this oculomotor nuclei, the third cranial nerve, it supplies mainly all the extraocular muscles. Except lateral rectus . See I have written here, oculomotor nerve supplies all the extraocular muscles except two muscles. They are nothing but lateral rectus muscle, which is supplied by the sixth cranial nerve, and superior oblique muscle, that is supplied by the fourth cranial nerve, that is trochlear nerve. Okay, that is the one function of the oculomotor nerve. And one more important function of the oculomotor nucleus, that is coming from this Edinger-Westphal nucleus, and that's why I have put it in separate color here. This Edinger-Westphal nucleus forms the preganglionic parasympathetic component of the oculomotor nerve. Remember, this Edinger-Westphal nucleus forms a preganglionic parasympathetic component. So these preganglionic parasympathetic fiber arising from the Edinger-Westphal segment of the oculomotor nerve runs in this way and comes to the orbit. In the orbit, they synapse within a ganglion called as ciliary ganglion. And after synapsing within the ciliary ganglion, the post ganglionic parasympathetic fiber, they run through these are all the small branches of the ciliary ganglion, which are called as short ciliary nerve. You will study in the orbit, okay? And after the synapse, the post ganglionic parasympathetic fiber passes through this short ciliary nerve and supply two more muscles. They are sphincter papillae . So postganglionic parasympathetic fiber supplies ciliaris muscle present within the ciliary body of the eyeball, that is mainly responsible for accommodation reflex, and it also supplies one more muscle, that is sphincter papillae muscle present in the iris, and name itself indicates it helps in the constriction of the pupil. So constriction of the pupil come under the light reflex, pupillary light reflex, whereas contraction of the ciliaris muscle helps in the increased convexity of the lens, thereby helping in the accommodation reflex. So in a single statement, I repeat again, ciliaris muscle contribution is in the accommodation reflex, and sphincter pupillae helps in the constriction of the pupil, the majority of the role in the light reflex. So these are the two muscles supplied by the postganglionic parasympathetic fibers coming from the ciliary ganglion, and this ganglion receives the preganglionic parasympathetic fibers from the Edinger Westphal nucleus. After talking about oculomotor nuclear complex with the Edinger Westphal importance, now here I am talking about the importance of pretectal nucleus, the functional aspect. So see here, the left and right oculomotor, and this is a left and right pretectal nuclei. I have labeled it here. Okay, now coming back, let us start from the sensory stimulation. There is a light, source of light here falling onto the retina. Okay. And this light information carried by the optic nerve, optic chiasm and optic tract, which comes to lateral geniculate body. This is a lateral geniculate body. Okay, you will study this in the visual pathway in the physio department. Okay, so the light information coming via left optic nerve, left optic tract and left lateral geniculate body, and also from the left superior brachium, from the left lateral geniculate body and from the left superior brachium, light information comes to pretectal nucleus. Here I am choosing the left pretectal nucleus, and from the left pretectal nucleus, the further the information will go to left oculomotor nuclear complex, stimulating the left Edinger Westphal, and also go to contralaterally to the opposite side of the Edinger Westphal nuclear complex. So a particular pretectal nucleus, it makes ipsilateral as well as contralateral neuronal connection with the Edinger Westphal, and through this ipsilateral it brings pupillary constriction whenever there is a light stimulation, that talks about direct light reflex. This talks about direct light reflex, whereas this contralateral connection of the pretectal with the Edinger Westphal talks about consensual light reflex. So a stimulation of one pretectal nucleus by the light, it can have both direct light reflex and indirect, or you can say consensual light reflex via pupillary constriction, that is by the contraction of the sphincter pupillae muscle.